Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. So today I'm going to be covering 90 Day Fiance Season 6, Episode 6. So let's jump into it. This episode was boring with a capital B. I was cooking while I was watching this episode, barely paying attention. And next thing you know, like, the episode was done. There wasn't really much drama, so I was kind of just like, TLC's getting a little bit soft on me. I was kind of just like, meh. So, with that being said, let's get into the first couple. So, Ashley and Jay. Ashley and Jay's storyline has been pretty boring for the last, like, two or three episodes. This time, the problem they're having is with the communication amongst themselves. And with, Ashley has a problem with Jay speaking with people in Jamaica. Or people of the opposite sex in Jamaica. The whole issue with him, with her not liking who he's talking to and blah blah blah, like, who cares if she's in Jamaica? Ashley needs to calm down with that. Like, they're in Jamaica, like, what do you think is gonna happen? Like, he's gonna cheat on you, he's gonna go see her? Type of thing. You were all, like, fine and I don't care if Jesus told me when he was in Jamaica, like, you also can't expect for him to kind of drop everybody and not speak with them because he's not in their country, he's not in the country anymore, or in his country anymore. And I wasn't liking her little snippy attitude about that, like, who are you talking to, blah 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 blah. I kind of felt like it was, they're playing it up a little bit too much for TLC, and like, they don't have those type of major issues, but that's the problem they have. Another problem they have that Ashley mentioned is communication. So I guess when Jay wants to go somewhere, he just kind of leaves and goes, and he doesn't like consult or talk to Ashley, which I can understand it being a problem, but I feel like they were kind of making it out to be this big deal, especially because I do agree with Jay, like, where is he going, type of thing. You already explained that this community is like full of white people that could potentially be racist, that could potentially be prejudiced. They haven't seen a black person before. And then, like, where is he supposed to be going? Like, was he always just gets up and leave and goes to that barbershop? I feel like their storyline, this episode, was kind of, like, meh, and they were trying so hard to kind of cause problems within their storyline. So I was kind of just, like, I was over it. I wasn't really paying attention to them, and it seemed like a non-issue for them. Something they can get over really quickly. Not enough for it to be like, oh, who are you talking to? You're cheating on me, type of thing. They try to make it out like that, but like, TLC, who are you kidding? Like, I could tell it was lies. So, okay, next we're talking about Colt and Larissa. And usually Colt and Larissa, if they don't have drama, they have the jokes. This time, I think it was, their segment was very bland. Their whole problem was Larissa getting jealous of Colt. Not necessarily jealous, but she was offended that he had complimented a girl on her glasses. God forbid, like, she has nice glasses. And she was kind of just like, Colt, like, you never say how beautiful I am, like, what the hell? Which I don't believe her. Like, she is a very beautiful girl. And I'm sure Colt has let her know on multiple occasions how beautiful she is. So I was just like, shut up, Larissa. And then she had the nerve to be calling Colt an attention whore and stuff. I swear, like, with what's happening in current days, I would say Larissa is the attention whore. She's, like, delusional and crazy. And I don't know why Colt would want to marry her, be with her, or anything, because I can't imagine enduring like 5 minutes of her, much less like living with her. There really wasn't much to their story, and it's Colt saying like, baby, like, blah blah blah. He did admit that he's 97% sure that he wants to marry her and stuff. It's a very good percentage, but I can understand where Lewis is coming from of just like, wow, you're not like 100% positive. You're just kind of like, I really want to do this, kind of. And there's that little doubt, which it's all Colt is only being honest with himself, but like I think the 97% is more like, I'll be a bit nicer, more like 80% instead of like he really likes her, but he's not 100% sure because he knows what it'll take to kind of keep this marriage from not from like striving and not falling apart. And to deal with Larissa is, it takes a strong person, and I think he's kind of figuring out whether he's a strong person. He also is very easy to like please Larissa. So when she's mad and stuff, she was mad about the whole like Colt not being 100%, and then all he did was like book a place to go see like a venue, and she's like, "Oh my God, I like him now." Blah blah blah. She's very materialistic, and I think Colt will use that to his advantage in the down the line in the future, just being like, "I know you don't like, I know you're mad at me at this, but I bought you this, and this is the biggie thing, and this is the bettery thing, and it's not gonna get better." So, good luck with Colt and Larissa, but they were boring this episode. Next, we're gonna talk about Jonathan and Fernanda. Okay, Jonathan and Fernanda finally have some kind of real drama. He brings her to Chicago so she can finally meet his family in person, and so she can feel more comfortable about making this decision to leave everything in Mexico to live with John. So she meets his sister. I forgot her name, but she's older than Fernanda, which is a little bit weird. Especially because John's younger sister's age range is like 10 years. So that's like her big, big brother. And yet his wife is like younger than her. But she was a little bit skeptical of like John making this decision all of a sudden to marry her, but then she was very like warm and inviting, and she's spoken to Fernanda before, and this is kind of seeing it in person and kind of getting to know a little bit about her and her being okay with the decision of them getting married. It's a tough pill to swallow if you don't maybe think it's right, but believe me, John is upgrading. It's Fernanda that's kind of downgrading. Fernanda might be young, but she's much more mature than Jonathan. And usually, sometimes in those scenarios, you'll see like because she's younger, her family being very protective and not allowing this. But it's the opposite of his family, even though he's older and he's grown, his family being very objective. Not objective. His parents or his family objecting to the situation. So I was just kind of like, I was like, okay. And then she meets his mom. And I don't know if it's the Chicago way and stuff, but she was salty. Like, she came off salty, throwing shade. He and her were throwing shade back and forth towards each other. Fernanda's right that they don't know how to speak to each other with respect. They were just kind of, they were spilling tea too. I was just like, what? This is so, I felt like so awkward, and I couldn't imagine being in Fernanda's situation. She's trying to make a good impression on his mom, tell his mom that, like, I love your son, he's the one for me, even though his mom has doubts and stuff, which, like, okay, you can have doubts and stuff. You don't have to agree with their situation and stuff, but your son has grown, so you also can't tell him he can't do it. I understand the way you weren't happy with the way that you learned about the situation, but it is what it is. They're engaged now. You kind of can't go back in time and fix that. Like, it would happen, happen. But I feel like she was very salty. And then Jonathan telling her, "Oh, when did you have me again? What, were you like 20 or something and stuff?" She's like, "I was 22 and a half. Don't get it twisted. Like, I'm married at 20, so come correct." And then Jonathan was like, "Oh yeah, you can give us advice. How long have you been married for? Or how many times have you gotten married?" And And then his mom was like, "Oh, so what? She's gonna be 30. So it's a fine when she's 30 and you're like 52, right?" And then John's like, "I would be like 42 and stuff. Like, don't get the, you're like, we're 12 years apart. Like, don't get it twisted. That's wrong. Get your math together." And guys is like, "Damn, like, are you sure that they like each other and stuff?" And his mom didn't really do anything to make Fernanda feel like she was happy with the situation, or even she was just accepting it. It was still very like on the fence, like, "I'm gonna think about if I like if you guys are together." And if I was 19-year-old Fernanda, I would have done the same thing when her mom left, cry. When his mom left, just cry and be like, "The family doesn't like me, and like the mom is a very important part of the family, and she's like, if she's not, she's close to like the head of the family if she's not." And to get a mother's acceptance is like so much. It means so much. It holds so much a weight. And she didn't get the acceptance, and it was more like, "Oh, I'll think about it if I like you," type of thing. And that was devastating, and I could understand why Fernando was hurt by it. So next we're gonna go with Claudia and Asuelo. Their segment was really boring. Claudia, I don't know if Claudia thinks that Asuelo is going to like take the baby by the foot and just like whoosh, and like whip it, or he's gonna do was it shaken baby syndrome and stuff. Like, she really thinks like her son is in danger. And like, I think it's one of those TLC ploys that are trying to make it seem like Asuelo is gonna like, I don't know, one day like accidentally swing the baby and like drop him. And like, Asuelo is naive, but he's not like, he has common sense, type of thing. And he's a new father. He's been doing this for, I don't know, say like a month, say 6 weeks, type of thing. You're gonna make mistakes and stuff. And he didn't get that time to learn how to be a father from the beginning. He's coming in at a certain point, so like, you also have to give him time. And Kehlani is, I don't know, sometimes like I feel like she's over exaggerating. Like, this is the man that you decide to lay down with. This is the father of your child. You have to somewhat trust that Oliver's father will take care of him. And I think like it was kind of over the top, and like it seems like she trusts everybody else but the father. And she sends, I guess, Asuelo and Nick to go buy the baby some clothes, which I don't know what store they're in, because the two things they bought came up to $50. They needed to go to a Walmart or something. Like, I don't know if they were trying to buy him like a specific outfit, but I was just like, that's too much money for two items of clothing for an infant who will not be able to wear it a month from now. He tries to put the baby over his on his shoulder, but like, I think it wasn't like for anything like reckless. I think that like some babies are very like, they don't want to just be held one way. You guys change it up a bit. So he decides to put the baby at the top. I did not think that Asuelu was going to just hold the baby by the leg and just let go of the baby and expect the baby to sit up. I didn't expect that. I didn't think that at all. And he had the baby with his hands behind his back, or one hand. It doesn't matter. The baby's light enough where it's not like he's like, the baby will slip and you fall. So Asuelu had that going on, and then Nick was like telling him like, "No, you can't do that," and blah blah. And then he's picking out clothes, and then Oliver took it and put it in his mouth. He's like, "No, you can't do that," and stuff. Like, I don't think Osweiler would have stayed there and let the baby eat like clothes and stuff like that. And I felt like Nick was, I don't know, being a little bit overbearing and stuff, and treating him like he was a child, type of thing. And like, this is his kid, so I can understand you're coming from a point of like teaching and making sure, but like, Nick, do you have children? for you to be telling us, well, what to do and stuff like that. I think if you do, like, I think there are things that Oswelu really doesn't know, but I also think that if there's something that he doesn't know, all you have to do is kind of be like, hey, it's kind of most people do this, or it's recommended that they do this for a baby and stuff like this. I just want to let you know and stuff like that. Instead of being like, no, don't do that, do this. No, don't do, like, how you would talk to a child. And Asuelo was just like, what the F? Like, I'm tired of your brother being weird, I'm not being trusted with the baby and stuff like that. And Kalani's like, I don't know if I can marry you because you might be a danger to my baby or whatever. I was just like, their segment was like boring. I wasn't here for it, and I was just like, shut up. Okay, so next we're gonna do Eric and Lita. So Eric and Lita really brought the drama. They're a couple that I hate, but I need them to be on the show, or else I probably would not watch the show. I'm surprised that Lita actually helps Eric clean up the house, even though Eric should have cleaned up the house when he is home alone on that one night, but he didn't. The clothes they wear to clean up the house is like funny because like Lita wears like a muumuu, and then Eric wears like the cut-off sleeves and stuff. His hair is always stays looking greasy, and it's just like it's gross. So anyways, they are cleaning up the house from top to bottom and stuff, and then they're expecting Tasha to come home. Lita's pissed and can't stand Tasha yet. She hasn't met her yet and wants her gone. And I feel like Eric didn't do enough as a father to be like, she's going to move out, but it's not happening today, type of thing. But I'm going to help her work on her getting a new spot. So Tasha comes home and stuff, and as someone comes home to your house to the house and there's new people you don't know, you greet them, and she greeted everybody. Lita is standing there like pretending that like Tasha didn't like say something to her. And like she's trying to be pleasant, and Lita was like, like, I'm so upset and stuff. And I'm just like, yo, girl, can you at least pretend? But was it Eric sent Tasha a little a text letting her know that like Lita was not happy about the condition the house was left in. And I can understand like Lita not being happy, but like if I'm not happy, I'm taking it up with Eric. I'm not taking it up with his daughter. His daughter, I don't know, I haven't met yet. Like Eric lives here too. So she's talking to her and stuff and trying to ask her questions, getting to know her, and Lita's giving her the cold shoulder, and then Lita's like, you know what? I was really mad that you left the house like this. Was it your intentions? And she said no. Believe me, the house is like cleaner than this. It's just that like she was busy and stuff, which I beg to differ because the house looked dirty from day one. And Lita's like, did you want me to get upset and stuff? And she's like, no, I did not feel that way. And then Lita's like, you need to move out. Like, Lita didn't, let's be honest, Lita didn't care what she had to say. Lita's just like, okay, you need to move out, and it needs to be done today. I'm like, Lita, like that's very unreasonable. Like, what's wrong with you? And like, you can't just move out like that. Like, oh, you know, like I can find an apartment like today. It doesn't work that way. There's processes that need to happen before you get an apartment. So Tasha was just like, well, I'm not moving out today because like that's unreasonable. I'm looking for a place. I put in applications and stuff. Like, she also needs money and stuff like this. Like, there's other factors to consider, like, before you just move out on your own. And then Eric's, like, in the corner, just like, yeah, so blah, blah, blah. Like, Eric, what's wrong with you? You're not even standing up for your daughter. You're letting this girl like talk bad about your daughter. You're just like, well, were you really sorry and stuff? Like, it's a yes or no. And then what got me so heated is when Eric's like, oh, we can bring you to like a budget motel. You know, the ones that you pay for a day, like daily or weekly. Excuse me? I'm supposed to leave my place that I pay rent in for this for a motel. I felt it was so disrespectful that he recommended it. I was just like, Eric, that shouldn't have never come out of your mouth. That was very disrespectful. Your daughter, I'd rather you propose your daughter moves in with her mom or something like that than to say she moves in a dutty motel. Whew. Eric ain't shit and Lita ain't shit. And Lita is very disrespectful, and I think there's a segment where she is talking to the camera and she goes, this is me, Eric, and Alessandro's like family type of thing. She does not regard was it Eric's daughters as part of the family. Like, they're just like the other. And I don't know if it's her age, and she's just, because they're much older, she can't see herself playing a stepmom, but I don't know. She needed to come correct, because this is not just you and Alessandra and Eric. There's other people involved in this family. So you can't kind of bum rush all his family out and then have him just focus on you. And she wasn't happy about that, but like, sucks to be her. I'm done with her. And then last but not least, we do Olga and Steven. There really wasn't much. Steven needs to get his anger under control. He gets a little bit heated too quickly. He doesn't know how to talk to Olga. I can understand his whole, I don't like when people tell me what to do because of like his family and then the problems he has, but like, I feel like those are two different problems he's dealing with, and he's trying to combine it as one. He is not being empathetic towards Olga, like at all. It's like, why aren't you doing this? Why are you doing that? Don't talk to me like that. Like, he is not grasping that she just had a child and she had major surgery, and that you need to calm down, and that she's in protective mommy mode right now. And with your anger and the way you're snapping on her, she's gonna become very defensive, and she's going to stand her ground because her baby's involved. So, Steven, when she says to wash your hands, even if she tells you 50 times, even for you to say, Olga, I want to touch the baby, but look, I'm gonna go and wash my hands. Just do it. Like, I don't understand why you have to fight with her over and over again. And then you get very disrespectful in the way your tone is. Like, stop it. Like, and like, you're making this girl cry and stuff. Like, she has so much other crap to worry about than dealing with your anger. So I'm just like, Stephen, like, stop it. Like, grow up. And I think that this is something that he's gonna have to learn to, I would say calm down, but like, you can't tell somebody to calm down. Like, it doesn't necessarily work like that, but he needs to learn how to channel his anger into something else, and to think before he speaks, and change the tone of his voice and change his attitude, because it's like, it's getting too much where I'm just like, you're kind of verbally abusing her and stuff. And she could easily end this visa process and then have her baby stay in Russia, and you go back to the States and you deal with your shit, because I don't think she'll feel comfortable going to America knowing you're going to be the way you are currently, and that's not right. So I hope that Steven picks up on this and like changes. So that's all for the couples. next episode looks a little bit better, but I'm just like, I feel like there's more drama and there's more, I guess more story to their like current real lives versus now. I do follow everything that's happening with all the couples in like recent times, as in like today and stuff, and it's way more juicy than what they have in on TLC and stuff. I never talk about them here because I just like to fully concentrate on the episode itself. But that concludes my recap of 90 Fiance season 6 episode 6. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Thanks for watching.
Just a dumb cunt, fucking sick and tired of it. Maybe I could front love, maybe I could buy a zip. Maybe I get fucked up, next time I could save some. Why it's gotta be like this? Why it's gotta be that way? Put it inside yourself, rise up, banging on that loud.